Michelle Mike. Is that
Henry?
Thank you. We'll just do some audio testing. Is that good for people way down there? Yes? Sweet. Thanks.
This is the bit where it goes all over the place.
Thanks.
Thank you.
Great. Thank you, Joe, and thank you, everyone, for having me. It's an absolute treat to be here. Thanks for coming out on a school night. Such an excellent event. Look, when Joe asked me, I was really thrilled to come and have the opportunity to speak about this topic. It's something I've been passionate about for quite a while. And so really over the next half an hour, I just want to share with you what I've learned from other people much more experienced than me in this, but also draw on some of my own experiences, particularly around coaching and being coached. So that's a funny little build that just happened there, isn't it? Oh well, moving on. So in the next half an hour, I hope that, you know, we will have explored a little bit about you know, what's great about coaching and mentoring. Hopefully you'll be inspired to either get one or be one, and then at least learned one new thing, possibly two or three, from listening to my experiences and perhaps reflecting on your own. Before we get cracking, though, can we just have a show of hands? Pop your hand up if you are being coached or have ever been coached or mentored. That is a substantial amount of the room. Excellent. And what about if you have been a coach or a mentor to someone else? Still a significant amount. Okay, so I'm preaching to the converted. That's pretty clear. Look, many of you will already have a good idea of what that experience is like, one way or another. And if you haven't, if you didn't put your hand up, then we'll have some information at the end about the IXDA mentoring program so you can get involved, and some information about coaching as well. But even if you haven't, you've probably had someone in your life who's given you some awesome advice or guidance at a time when you really needed it. And when you reflect on that, you might think that person's a bit of a coach or a mentor. So in the spirit of keeping it real, which is on the ticket for tonight's event, it's good for you to know a little bit about me. So as Joe said, I'm at Meld Studios, which makes me very happy. But what's more important really is when I started is about my passion in coaching. So about 10 years ago, I looked into trying to study coaching, and I thought, this is an awesome area and it joins all these things that I really love. How can I make a career out of it? And so I found this great course by a group called Results Coaches. And the guy that runs that is a really clever Aussie called David Rock. And I did intensive coach training, theoretical foundations with David Rock, which was a thrill, and coach's toolkit. So I didn't end up making a career out of it. I'm now still incredibly lucky to be part of this awesome design community. Thanks for coming out again. But what it did was it really created a spark and made me curious about this area. And it was a massive growth industry at the time. In 2012, I think they estimated it's a $2 billion industry a year. So, but more important than that, I really loved that I could see that it was making a difference in people's lives. So the two things I particularly loved about it in this study in particular was that it was grounded in science. So back then, talking about neuroscience and brain-based research was still pretty new. It's now become pretty commonplace in a lot of business arenas. And so applying that knowledge through various coaching techniques to facilitate others to tap into their inherent and innate potential was a pretty great thing to behold. And so the second thing that really flicked my switch, I guess, was that coaching assumes that the person you're coaching already has that inherent capacity and potential for insight. And so whether they want to grow, make change, lift their performance at work, do they want to change some behaviours, do they want to drop some habits that are really not serving them anymore. So whatever it is they're seeking, your role as coach is really to draw that out and bring it to life in them. So to explain that a little bit further, I just want to have a look at a model that's been useful for me to understand this area. And we start to touch on mentoring a bit more in this too. So there are two axes here. The horizontal is this ask and tell continuum, which I've found incredibly useful. And then the other is problem and solution. And so coaching sits perhaps more on this solution and ask end. And there's certainly overlap and there's certainly different styles of coaching. And this part is certainly not an exact science, but that's kind of where that sits. And mentoring is a little bit more on this sort of tell end. So the coach is trained to use tools and ask lots of questions to elicit the response in you, whereas the mentor, you're often choosing a mentor, sometimes from the same industry but sometimes not, a mentor who can, I guess, provide you with advice and guidance and share a lot of their own experience that you can then draw from. And people who have mentored, and there are a lot, are probably looking at that thinking, yeah, but actually I take a really coaching style approach to the way that I'm mentoring my people. And that's absolutely true. Lots of people do. And that's why those lines are a bit blurry. So it's not black and white, but the good thing about this model is really it's more to get an understanding of there are different styles and different approaches. So you're, as a mentee or a coachee, going to have a preference for the type of dynamic that you want with your coach or your mentor. And you, as a coach or mentor, are going to have a certain way of approaching it. So when I was coached for the first time about 5 years ago, I'd done plenty of counselling, which is really down this end of understanding, like really digging into the problem, and the counsellor asking you lots of questions. I've had heaps of counselling. I'm just as dysfunctional as the next person. So I was very familiar with that. And when I went to get a coach, despite the fact that we're still over here on this ask side, I really wanted to get someone who was actually going to just tell me what she thinks I should do. And fortunately, I found a coach like that. So she was not backwards in coming forwards. I would say at times she even went for the jugular. But she did it in a really respectful way, and she knew my boundaries, and we had good boundaries between us. And so that actually worked for me really well. So with all that in mind, it's important to remember coach or coachee, mentor or mentee, to just be aware of the style that you want, and maybe that will evolve over time, but also the way that you deliver mentoring or coaching to the person who's at the receiving end. In terms of the differences and the similarities, coaching is often short-term, and it's often to do with the role you're in now and the next role, whereas mentoring is sort of often over a longer period of time, so over a wider span of your career development, covering many, many roles. Coaching, if it's external to where you are, is often paid, whereas mentoring is typically voluntary, which is handy. And then also coaching often works a lot on, I guess, specific skills development, whereas mentoring can be a bit more broad and can be quite specific to your industry. So moving on from there, I think what's really fascinating is what they've got in common. So the best thing is they're both all about growth, both your professional and your career growth. And I think sometimes those things get a bit blurry. Things that you learn as you're trying to develop yourself in your career, you actually take into your personal life, and you find they're much more useful in there. So that's a really awesome thing about both of them. They can both be, I believe, tactical and strategic. So despite the fact I just described coaching as more of this short-term dealing with skills, what I got from my coaching engagement were ideas that helped me plan and think about what it was going to be like down the track. So I think both coaching and mentoring offer that. Back to this intrinsic capability, it's just such a beautiful thing to not necessarily have this, well, I know everything and I'm going to teach you type arrangement. And if you've got a coach or mentor like that, maybe that's not such a great dynamic, is to help to draw that out of the person that you're coaching or mentoring. And then the onus is on the individual to take action. So the coach and the mentor they're not going to go away and do heaps of prep. They're going to turn up on the day. They're going to deal with what you present to them. Perhaps in a coaching relationship, it's a little bit more structured perhaps, and it's a bit more fluid in a mentoring relationship. again, it depends a little bit on the person, but certainly the onus is on the individual to do what they've set out to do. One of the important things about that is that if you haven't been coached or mentored and you're thinking of getting one, don't be daunted by the idea that you're going to commit to someone else that you're going to set yourself these tasks. And if you don't get them done by the next one, I suspect your coach or mentor is not going to be there ticking off the list and crossing it off. What's important and the good conversation that you can have out of that is, if you didn't get to do that thing or you didn't get to explore that, let's have a look at why and what was getting in your way. That's often a much richer conversation than ticking off a list or feeling like you have to perform because you've made a commitment to someone else. So what's in it for you guys? Well, here are four beautiful things, the gold, I think, that you can take out of a coaching relationship. Confidence is a big one, to explore, make change, take risks. And in preparing for this talk, I had some really good conversations both with mentors and mentees, and they were saying, maybe it seems obvious that the mentee is the person getting confidence from this type of dynamic, but actually the mentors were saying it gave me confidence because I had to think about what I offered, and then when I actually started the relationship, I was like, yeah, actually, I know quite a bit about this. This is good. I can add value here. So that was a really lovely thing to hear. So insight, it's quite a unique relationship and quite different to all your other relationships, in that you've got a very specific intent and it's very focused. And so it really allows you to have those sparks, and for someone outside of your normal realm who's probably less biased than the people that you know really well, start to ask you questions and drill into things that help you connect ideas that you've not connected before. The learning part cuts both ways, as I described, in confidence. The mentors and coaches, particularly mentors, you know, learn a lot from their mentees, and I know that's something that IXDA Sydney chapter really encourage. And then the final thing is perspective. So there's this non-judgmental one-to-one arrangement where this person's completely focused on you and really just helps you perhaps not be so hard on yourself, because we're all our own worst critics. They help you to lift out of that, reflect things back to you and say, well, actually, you did this, this and this. This was actually quite hard. What have you learned about that? And that just helps you to support yourself a bit better. So these are just a few comments that I got this week. So every time I mentor someone, they quit their job and get a much better work-life balance than me. Which was a beautiful comment. I did giggle when I read that, because that's someone I've actually worked with before. So yeah, look, it is rewarding for the coach or the mentor to see the person flourish, and sometimes it can certainly inspire them to make changes in their life too. You learn a lot about yourself when you talk about your reactions and how you might handle something. So that sort of learning through dialogue thing can be really powerful, particularly in such a focused session. Also, you know, this was from a fabulous colleague I got in the last couple of days. It's a relationship that sits outside, you know, of a lot of relationships. It's honest and real with real meaning and intent. I just think that's a beautiful sentiment and really sums up the uniqueness of our coaching or a mentoring dynamic. Cool. So here are a few things that I learned, mainly from being coached, and then a couple of techniques that I adopted in my own coaching. So discovering your strengths. The coach that I had, Gemma, was awesome at really helping me not focus on all the stuff that I was crap at and not try and be everything to everyone. And we did the Gallup strength survey. Is it people familiar with that? Who's familiar with Gallup? Yep. And that was an awesome and very powerful tool, which actually the organisation I was at ended up adopting maybe 3 or 4 years later. That really, it was great because it was very specific about what you wanted to focus on, and it kind of changed this idea of being well-rounded, because well-rounded can often lead to beige and not that interesting. So she was really encouraging me to embrace my idiosyncrasies and quirks and the stuff that made me different, to really own those and to work on my strengths and amp up my strengths, as opposed to trying to fix all the stuff that I thought was broken and that I thought everyone needed. So that was really powerful and something that I've actually taken into people leadership positions since. I've touched on this quite a bit. You know, you're your own worst enemy, and you're often really hard on yourself. And a fabulous woman that I used to work with called Sarah Stokes introduced me to the sphere of influence, circle of influence and circle of concern. So the circle of concern is huge. It's got everything in it. It's got work stuff, it's got home stuff, it's got emotional, mental, physical, environmental. It's got everything. It's the stuff that stresses you out and gets you down. And as the name suggests, you know, the circle of influence is the stuff that you can actually do something about. So when you sit down and use a tool like this with a coach, or perhaps even with someone you're managing at work, or a colleague or a peer, it's just a really useful tool to dissect, understand what you can do about it, but also then the conversation can go into, well, and what do you need to let go? And that then points you back up to, and now you can focus on what you're really good at, because you don't have all this other stuff clouding you. The Ask Tell Continuum was hugely helpful to me, because I thought that I loved just being asked questions and crapping on for an hour, but actually it was more important to me at that point in time to have someone who was a bit more assertive, who I could say to them, so after all the stuff I've just told you, what does your gut tell you about what you think I should do next? And they'd give me some suggestions, and it was really tangible and really useful. And then the other thing was distilling down what you want to do, and the exercise that I did with her related to what do you want to be known for. And so it was good to craft that into essentially a hashtag, I guess. So what do you want to be known for, so that then you could take tangible steps towards that. So how to choose one. These are just three things that I think are really important. So go for chemistry and connection. Make sure that you have a good rapport with this person. And I was chatting to Vera just before, and we were talking about the fact that sometimes it can be pretty daunting for someone who's new to mentoring and coaching if they have a mentor and they're not really clicking, and they're sort of like, oh, this isn't working, but I better keep going because they're giving up their time and they're awesome. So I would really encourage you to perhaps trust your gut. Certainly don't give up after the first 10 minutes, but maybe have a few sessions, and then be up front when the arrangement starts and say, look, why don't we do, can we do three sessions, and can we check in after three sessions or something like that? Don't hesitate when it comes to perhaps making a change, because I know the IXDA mentoring program, they do a lot of work in trying to match participants, and that's really hard to do and admirable and great on paper, but you can never know what the dynamic's going to be like when you're sitting down in front of someone, or even if you're on the phone or on Skype or however you're doing your session. Do you admire their work? Not just the output though, and not just their profile. Another wise person this week shared that idea with me, and the coach that I had, I actually spoke to this week, and she said that she had a coach who she'd seen behaving really badly. So the work was amazing, but she'd seen some really, as she described, reprehensible behaviour. And she was in this coaching arrangement, and it just made her feel a bit uncomfortable every time she had to be with this person. So make sure, if you can, find out a little bit about the person without being creepy and stalking them. But see if you can find out a bit about them. See if you can observe them in the wild at an event like this, perhaps. That might really help create that chemistry that you need to have a really rewarding exchange. Make sure the person, if you can, is fairly open. Obviously, supportive is pretty key, that goes without saying. But we'll also challenge you respectfully. So depending on where you'd like to be on that ask, tell, continuum, if you do want a bit of a push and someone to challenge you, make sure they're doing it in a way that, I guess, doesn't leave you feeling a little bit uncomfortable. Make sure that you can have robust conversations, but also don't shy away from those robust conversations, because sometimes mentors are really looking to help push you. And if they can do that in a respectful way, that can be really rewarding. So just a few myths. I think I've touched on a couple of these already. So do you need to have the person who's the best in the business? No, not necessarily. I know that, okay, thanks. I thought Joe wanted to say something there because I was about to talk about the IXDA. Yeah, sorry. I know that you guys in your mentoring program encourage designers who have had maybe 2 to 3 years experience to be mentors, and that can be hugely useful because the person who's being mentored is now talking to someone who was there not that long ago. And so that experience can be really relevant and can really connect with you in a way that someone with 20 years experience who's been away from the tools or away from what you're doing for a really long time, that might create a bit of a gap. If you've only had a short time in the game, that sort of talks to what I've just described there. Is your boss always your coach? Despite the prevalence of coaching as part of what is now leadership training, bosses and managers aren't always good coaches and don't always necessarily know what a coaching conversation looks like. In your job, I would encourage you, if you can, to talk to your boss, if possible, about whether they've done any coaching training. That might be a little bit daunting, but if possible, it's something to learn about. The mentee isn't the only one learning, as I described before. The mentor's often getting a lot out of it too. So what next? Get amongst it. The Sydney IXDA chapter have a fabulous mentoring program, and they're 5 weeks into their current one, which ends on the 30th of November, and the next session starts February, March. So get in touch with Joe, Ron, Vera, Mary, or Kevin to find out more. I know Joe and Vera are here tonight, and Kevin. Great. Great. Oh, hi, Ron. and then with coaching, you can look up the International Coach Federation site. There's 1,300 coaches registered with them in Australia, New Zealand. My excellent colleague, Sarah Stokes, has volunteered her time. She's currently studying her Master's in Business Coaching at the University of Wollongong. And when you're studying, it's really important to get as many hours as you can up and practice. And I know my friend Dom is already being coached by her and loves that experience. And afterwards, come and ask me about coaching in the workplace, because I think there are lots of great opportunities for you to get coaching in the workplace, not necessarily from your direct boss, but from other people. Cool, so just a couple of resources. I'm sure these will be online at some point. A few books. So David Rock, who created the course that I was talking about at the beginning, has a fantastic book called Your Brain at Work. The Art of Possibility and Rising Strong are not coaching or mentoring books, but can give you some really good ideas about your personal development and your career and how you can, I guess, be more courageous and trust yourself a bit more. And then the Gallup Strengths Finder is there as well. Cool. So have we got any time for questions, or are we out?
No.
Okay.
I've done it to include.
Thank you very much for having me.
Thanks, Beth. Yeah, okay, so you did have that in front. So, shall we see some hands? Has anyone got a question for Beth? And just give me a moment to get there with the mic. And...
Hi, Beth. Thank you. That's a really great introduction. You mentioned focus on strength. How would you respond to somebody who said, you know, Beck, I'm a bit bored with my strengths. It kind of comes naturally to me.
I'm a bit bored with them.
Bored.
Yeah.
You know, I know I'm good at it. It's like autopilot. I'd really love to the things I'm not necessarily good at. How would you respond to that?
That's a great question. I'd probably go in and explore, well, I'd get the strengths in front of us, and I'd explore a little bit more around what they're bored about first, but then understand what the weaknesses are that you want to work on. And there's a little model that you can use where you can, if you did want to focus on that, there's a model you can use around weaknesses where you delegate the weakness, you get someone to help you with it, or you just bag it. And so I think I'd probably explore that. I'd still want to go back to strengths, if I'm really honest. But I think if you do want to work on weaknesses, there's some really good models around how you can manage that and not be completely focused on it. Does that answer your question?
Yeah, maybe I'll see you later.
Okay.
And Beck's coming down for drinks as well, yeah?
Yes.
So,
and now.
Hi, Beck. Thanks for the presentation.
It's really a pleasure.
So I guess my question is, do you have an example of when someone has given you a respectful critique on something, maybe in the realm of, because I'm struggling to give someone some advice on, I guess, having more confidence and speaking with more authority. People are just starting out, they can be a bit wary of, maybe
I don't know enough, or I can't speak up as much as I'd like to, and how you would deliver that kind of feedback respectfully
in
the way that's constructive. I think I would start by probably asking them a few questions and saying something like, you're saying this person, you think they need more confidence, is that right? So start by talking to them about perhaps a specific experience where you've observed that. And then ask them a bit about how did that feel. They might go, that felt awesome. I was great. And then that gives you an understanding of, I guess, the gap between how you perceive them or how others perceive them, because maybe you're getting this feedback from other people, and then how they perceive themselves. And then perhaps you have an opportunity to kind of work back into the middle once you know what that gap is. But you're right, I had a conversation with Dom about this on the way down. Giving feedback's really hard. Something I found really hard when I was working at Westpac, and I also found it really hard to give feedback, dare I say, to people who were much older than me, and also to men. I had trouble with that, and I had to be coached through how to do that and what that meant. So yeah, I acknowledge that giving feedback's hard, and it's a very vulnerable process. But good on you for getting amongst it.
Got one on this side.
Thanks for the presentation. I'm just wondering if you've got any sort of top two or three questions that, if you're in a coaching role, to sort of kick off the process and start the sort of exploration of how the relationship can work.
You mean when you start a relationship?
Yeah. So what's some good sort of initial exploratory
Well, I think the first obvious one is what are you trying to achieve, and what do you want to get out of this exchange? Another good one is back to the strengths thing. So what do you think you're really good at now? How can we dial that up? And what do you think's getting in your way? I actually think what do you think's getting in your way is, as simple as that sounds, it's actually a really nice question that doesn't push them down the back into this negativity bias that we get into so often. It really allows them to go, yeah, well, that thing's getting in my way. And that kind of places it outside of them. And then you've got something more tangible to work with. And another very simple thing that I think elicits a good response in people is when someone's talking about what they want or what they're going to do, when they finish, instead of processing that and playing it back to them, just say, can you tell me a bit more about that? And it's really amazing to see what people come up with first, then you give them a breath to expand on it, extrapolate, use different words, whatever it is, it really allows them to make some new connections if you just give them that space. So can you tell me a bit more about that? I found to be hugely useful. Yeah.
No, God, it's a little bit like interviewing users.
Yeah.
And then you have that pause, you're really geared at trying to get them to open up and trying to build that relationship with them. So there's probably a few similarities from that as well.
Yes, and that reminded me of a bit that I missed. So in the chart where you've got mentoring, coaching, counselling, as designers, we can kind of overlay design on that because we're spending a lot of time getting to the nub of the problem and understanding the problem space, and you know, and then we're moving into solutions. So there's a whole design, I guess, wash that we can put over that that tackles all those things. Thank you for that.
You talked about working on people's strengths and potentially, you know, amplifying those as opposed to looking at their weaknesses. What happens when their passion is one of their weaknesses? How do you
Is it time? Are we done? That is such a great question. I'm just going to allow myself a few seconds to think about it. Perhaps not dissimilar. I'd be digging in a bit more about why they're passionate about it and why it really generates a lot of energy for them, because it's a weakness, I guess, is your perception. And perhaps other people have encouraged them down the path that they're awesome at that. And that has put them into a mindset where not only am I passionate about it, but I've had people telling me I'm awesome about it. Awesome at it, sorry. So I think I would just do a little bit of exploring. And then perhaps the conversation might move to the role, because they've got a passion for this thing that you believe is a weakness. You have a role that they need to do, a job, I assume. It's someone you're working with, or it's a total hypothetical?
It is kind of hypothetical.
Okay. I've got this friend.
No, there are aspects that you know, I have passion about that I'm weak in, so yeah.
Oh, God. Okay. Okay, that changes that question slightly. Well, that's you being hard on yourself, perhaps. Maybe it's more to do with that. Clearly, whatever you're passionate about generates a lot of energy for you. So there's always the opportunity to get better at it. It's like, what are the avenues that you can pursue to try and get better at it and turn it into a strength? I'm a bit of an optimist, so that's going to be the response.
Okay, we've got time for one more.
Hello.
So I've been coached, but I've also come across situations where I'm mentoring, but the person I'm mentoring doesn't necessarily have the language to articulate the things that they're feeling or the things that they are ambitious for, and so by communicating, I mean verbal. So what do you do when they don't have the language to describe it?
That is an excellent question. You've given me the answer on the walk down here.
Oh, did I?
Yeah. So thanks for that. What about drawing? What about saying, can you draw that for me? Why don't you tell the story of what you just described to me on the way down?
Do I tell the story?
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. Didn't even realize that.
Is that okay?
Yeah. No, that's totally okay.
Yeah.
So I was transitioning to become a senior designer. And there was a lot of stuff that was kind of getting in my way to becoming a senior designer that I couldn't really unlock. And so Sarah Stoke, you keep looking at that.
I know, because Ian's sitting there.
Oh, okay. I was going to choose you.
And he's my other favourite.
Yes. My coach Sarah Stokes asked me to draw the thing that was getting in my way. And the thing that came out was a very abstract, volcanic rock thing that was being dragged down.
Chained down,
yeah. And it was just about labeling that, but I think it was that process. Yeah, I totally do have the answer.
You do.
it was that process of getting it out, seeing it, and then reflecting on it.
That may help. Even for people who say, I can't draw and I can't sketch.
Yeah.
It might be an opportunity to explore that. I know with kids, when they don't have the words for feelings in a psychology arrangement, you know, they do art therapy and they get them to draw how they're feeling as opposed to, because they don't necessarily have the words, so why it doesn't have to be any different for us.
Yeah. Thank you for reflecting that
second.
Coaching 101. Well, the answer was in here.
That was some really awesome Darth Vader shit you just did.
Thank you, Pat. Thank you. Fabulous. Thanks so much for having me. Thank you.